Hello aspirants, welcome to Prelim Series Season 2 by IIS by Heart. Once again, welcome you all to the Session 22 of Prelim Series Season 2. In this session, we are going to look at 10 most probable questions that can feature in your upcoming prelims examination 2021. As we told earlier, these 10 questions have been modeled based on the analysis of last 5 years of UPSC prelims question papers. And most of the questions have been taken from the most basic sources such as NCERT. So make sure that you are extracting best out of it. Without any further delay, let's get into the discussion. The first question, in the context of Indian polity, which one of the following is the most appropriate definition of freedom? So question is about definition of freedom. So this question has been taken from the polity topic. Okay. So if you go through these four statements, first option, absence of constraint. B, option an opportunity to develop oneself fully. Option C, individuals would be inviolable. Option D, absence of privileges. So this question has been inspired from this 2019 question paper. So in that year, UPSC asked a definition of liberty, most appropriate definition of liberty. So by inspiring from this question, we have formulated this question. And then there are four options given. We should find the correct one. So in this regard, definition of liberty means opportunity to develop oneself fully. Okay, this is the exact appropriate definition of liberty. Okay, so now I will give you 10 seconds to answer this question before proceeding to the explanation page. So before solving this question, we are moving to explanation for extracting more information about freedom. Okay, so freedom means absence of constraint. So there would be no constraint for the development of individual and the society. So freedom exists when external constraints on the individual are absent. Okay, absence of constraint. An individual could be considered free if he or she is not subject to external control or coercion and is able to make independent decisions. That is what they ensure them freedom in Indian polity. Okay, freedom is also about expanding the ability of people to freely express themselves and develop their potential. Okay, so this is also an important abbreviation of freedom, definition of freedom. Both these aspects of freedom, absence of external constraints as well as the existence of conditions in which people can develop their talents, are important for a thriving democracy. So based on these values only, thriving the democracy can be ensured. So after going through all this information, we are coming back to solve this question. So based on this explanation, we can conclude that option A is the correct answer. Absence of constraint is the most appropriate definition of freedom. Okay, solving this question, moving on to next question. Question 2, consider the following statement. This question has been taken from modern history. First statement, at the opening of Benares Hindu University, Gandhi charged on Indian elite with the lack of concern for the laboring poor. So Gandhi is always emphasizing on the laboring poor and the lower strata of the society. And his economy model was based on the greater decentralization. It was the Rowlatt Satyagraha that made Gandhiji a truly nationalist leader. Okay. Third statement, as a consequence of non-cooperation movement, the British Raj was taken to its foundation for the first time since the revolt of 1857. Which of the statements given above is correct? There are four options given. We should find the correct option. So this question has been inspired from this question. It was taken from 2019. So in that year, the same type of question have been asked. So based on this formula, we have adopted this question. So question is about here also Mahatma Gandhi, and it is about salt law, breaking of salt law. Okay. So based on this question, we have formatted this question. Now I will give you 10 seconds to answer this question before proceeding to the explanation page. So before solving this question, we are going to extract more information regarding this question. Okay, when Gandhi returned to India in 1955, Gandhi returned to India in the year of 1915 from South Africa. Gogole advised Gandhiji to spend a year traveling around British India, getting to know the land and its people. So Gopalakrishna Gogole was a political guru of Gandhi. So he advised Gandhi to spend some time to getting to know the India and its people. Gandhi's first major public appearance was at the opening of the Benares Hindu University in February 1916. So this is the first conference in which Gandhi made public appearance in India. When Gandhi came to speak, he charged the Indian elite with the lack of concern for the laboring poor. Why? Because in Benares Hindu University Inauguration Foundation, there was a people who were, most of them are elite, and there was an absence of this laboring poor and rural people and lower section of the people. So the mass was absent. So Gandhi charged with this statement. It was Rowlatt Satyagraha that made Gandhiji a new true nationalist leader. Yes, this is the first Satyagraha which made Gandhi a national leader. Emboldened by its success, so Rowlatt Satyagraha was success. So emboldened by its success, Gandhiji called for a campaign of non-cooperation movement with British rule. As a consequence of non-cooperation movement, the British Raj was shaken to its foundation for the first time since revolt of 1857. So the chronological order is Gandhi came to India and made a tour, and then he launched Rowlatt Satyagraha. It was very success, and then based on that he launched non-cooperation movement. As a consequence of non-cooperation movement, British foundations were shaken. So based on this information, we are going to solve this question. So if you go through all these statements, statement 1, 2 and 3, all these statements are correct as we saw in the explanation page. So question is about correct statement. So the correct answer could be option D. All the statements are correct. Okay. So after solving this question, moving on to the next question, question 3. 15th Finance Commission uses which among the following criteria for horizontal division of tax proceeds? Okay. So question is from economy, especially from about 15th Finance Commission. So there are four options statements given. We should find the correct answer here. So this question has been modeled from the inspiration of 2018 question paper. In that question, question was about GST. So what are the items which comes under GST purview? So based on this formula, we have adopted this question here. So 15th Finance Commission becomes important for the upcoming prelims. Why? Because it has been frequently in news. Due to it submitted two reports and it changed the allocation of tax proceeds of between center and state. So these are the four criteria given here. So I will give you 10 seconds now to solve this question. So before solving this question, we are moving to explanation for getting more information regarding this question. So 15th Finance Commission, it is a constitutional body established under Article 280 of the Constitution. So it has been directly established from Constitution. That is why it is called as constitutional body. President of India Constitutive Finance Commission, it was constituted by President at an interval of 5 years or earlier. So whenever the need arises, he will form the Finance Commission, and the criterion for a maximum year is 5 years. It determines the method and formula for distributing tax proceeds between Union and state. So it determines the formula for the sharing of tax dividend between union and state. There are two devolution of tax. One is vertical devolution and next one is horizontal devolution. Vertical devolution means between the center and the state, and horizontal devolution means between the state to state. Okay. So it was constituted under the chairmanship of N.K. Singh. So the chairman of 15th Finance Commission was is N.K. Singh. Its recommendations will cover a period of 5 years from the year 2021-22 to 2025-26. So the 15th Finance Commission has submitted two reports, one for 2020-21, another one for 2025-26. Okay. It has recommended maintaining the vertical devolution at 41%. So from the tax devolution, the formula for tax devolution between center and state is fixed at 41%. For horizontal devolution, it has suggested criteria of demographic performance, income, population and area, forest and ecology, tax and fiscal effort. So these are the important criteria for the horizontal distribution of tax. Horizontal distribution of tax means distributing the tax resources between the states. Okay. So after going through all this information, we are coming back to solve this question. So if you go through all this question, forest and ecology is correct criteria, income decency is also correct one, demographic performance and tax and fiscal efforts. As we saw in the explanation page, here the demographic performance, income distance and everything has been added here. So the correct answer would be option D. All the statements are correct. Moving on to next question, question 4. This question has been taken from the geography. Okay. This question has been taken from the basic source NCERT from 9th standard and 11th standard. Okay. So in this season, form a period of transition from hot rainy to dry winter conditions. It is marked by clear skies and a rise in temperature. While day temperatures are high, nights are cool and pleasant. This shift is associated with the occurrence of cyclonic depressions. These characteristics features can be seen in. There are four options given: southwest monsoon, retreating or post monsoon season, hot weather season, cold weather season. So this question has been inspired from 2017 question paper. In that year, there was a character features have been explained here, and we should find the unique phenomenon of these characteristic in which places this unique character, unique phenomenon has been in geographical feature. Okay, so based on this question, we have adopted this same type here and formatted question. So I will give you 10 seconds for you to solve this question now. So before solving this question, we are moving to explanation to extract more information regarding this question. Okay, the first one is retreating monsoon. So the question is about a retreating monsoon. The months of October, November form a period of transition from hot rainy season to dry winter season. Yes, hot rainy season means it is a southwest monsoon season, and dry winter condition means northeast monsoon and winter season in India. Okay, winter season. Okay, the retreat of monsoon is marked by a clear skies and a rise in temperature. Okay, yeah, this characteristic has been prevailing in north and northern region of India. While day temperatures are high, nights are cool and pleasant. So there will be a greater temperature contrast between day and night. The land is still moist owing to the conditions of high temperature and humidity. The weather becomes rather oppressive during the day. Yes. So there will be more availability of moisture in daytime. So there will be oppressive weather in daytime. This is commonly known as October heat. This is famously called as October heat in geography parlance. The low pressure conditions over northern India get transferred to the Bay of Bengal by early November. So there will be a lower pressure belt in northern India. That is why the southwest monsoon wind becomes in this direction and going in that way to give rainfall. After southwest monsoon ended, the belt moves to Bay of Bengal region and southern region. That is why the winds are moving in this direction as an northeast monsoon. Okay, this shift is associated with the occurrence of cyclonic depressions which are incident over the Andaman Sea. Yes, this is also, yes, this is one of the important criteria for the northeast monsoon season. So after going through all this information, we are coming back to solve this question. So question is about the retreating or post monsoon. This is the correct answer. The correct answer could be option B. Moving on to next question, question 5. This question has been taken from environment topic. So why there is a difference in seasonal ice extent between Arctic and Antarctic region? There are four options given. We should find the correct one. Okay, this question has been modeled from this 2018 environment question. In that year, question was about coral reef and distribution and what are the threats. Okay, so based on this formula, we have formulated this question. The first statement, the Arctic is an ocean basin surrounded largely by mountain continental land masses, and Antarctica is a continent surrounded by ocean. Okay, B, the Antarctica is an ocean basin surrounded largely by mountainous continental land masses, and Arctic is a continent surrounded by ocean. Okay, in Arctic, sea ice extent is limited by surrounding land masses, and in Antarctic, sea ice can expand freely into the surrounding ocean. Okay, so I will give you 10 seconds now for you to solve this question before proceeding to the explanation for the more information. So before solving this question, we are moving to explanation page for extracting more information. Difference in seasonal ice extent between Antarctic and Arctic are due to basic geography and its influence on atmospheric and oceanic circulation. Yes, atmospheric conditions and oceanic circulation. Based on that, the seasonal ice extent is differing in both Arctic and Antarctic region. The Arctic is an ocean basin surrounded largely by mountainous continental land masses. Yes, if you look at this diagram, this is North Pole, that is Arctic region. This is full of water bodies surrounded by land masses here. And in the and Antarctica is a continent surrounded by ocean. Yes, if you look at this diagram, this is Antarctic. This is full of land masses, and it is surrounded by all these areas are ice and water. Okay, in the Antarctic, sea actually is limited by the surrounding land masses. Yes, this is full of water. This is land masses. So the spread of ice actually is determined by these land masses. In the southern ocean winter, sea ice can expand freely into the surrounding areas. Why? Because this is landmass. So these are all water. So it can expand outward from these land masses. So that there was a difference between the seasonal ice extent between Arctic and Antarctic region. Okay, with its southern boundary set by coastline of Antarctica. Okay, after going through all this information, we are coming back to solve this question. So the question is, in the Arctic is an ocean basin surrounded largely by mountainous continental land masses. Yes, and Antarctica is continent surrounded by ocean. This is correct. Antarctic is an ocean basin surrounded largely by mountain means continental landmass. Arctic is a continent surrounded by ocean. No, this has been interchanged now. So this will not be answer. In Arctic Sea actually is limited by the surrounding landmasses. Yes, correct. The Antarctic Sea ice can expand freely in the surrounding oceans. As we saw in the explanation page, both A and C are correct. So the correct answer could be option B. After solving this question, moving on to next question, question 6. This question is taken from agriculture topic. The key difference between natural farming and organic farming is there are four options given. We should find the correct one. So this question has been inspired from 2020 question paper. So in a recent year, last 2-3 years, UPSC has asked more question from agriculture topic. Why? Because there is a increasing production cost and the increasing farmer debt and the farmer suicide is happening in India. That is why UPSC has given a more emphasis on the practice of agriculture. So based on this formula, we have taken this question for the upcoming prelims. So I will give you 10 seconds now for you to solve this question before proceeding to the information area. So before solving this question, we are moving to explanation page. So question is about the difference between natural farming and organic farming. So natural farming is a system where laws of nature are applied to agriculture practices. Yes, this is eco-friendly and natural friendly, are adopting natural process. Okay, law of nature. Okay, the natural farming is an ecological farming approach. It is an ecological farming. Natural farming is an ecological farming approach established by Masanobu Fukui, a Japanese farmer and philosopher. Similarities between natural farming and organic farming. So both organic farming and natural farming are chemical free, more or less poison free farming methods. Both discourage farmers from using any chemical fertilizers, pesticides on plants in all agriculture practices. Both encourage farmer to use local breeds of seeds and native varieties of vegetables, grains, pulses and other crops. So if you go through all this information, these are all very ecological farming approach and they are adapting with law of nature. Okay, so and then organic and natural farming methods promote non-chemical and homemade pest control methods. Yes, this is one important feature of both organic and natural farming. But the key differences between natural farming and organic farming is in organic farming, organic fertilizers and manures are used added to farmlands from external sources. In natural farming, neither chemical nor organic fertilizers are added to the soil. This is what the key difference. In organic farming, organic fertilizers are used. Okay, but in natural farming, no organic farm, neither chemical nor organic fertilizers are used. In natural farming, decomposition of organic matter by microbes and earthworms is encouraged. So it is very close with the law of nature. Organic farming requires basic agro practices. So it will be more expensive compared to natural farming. In natural farming, there will be no plowing, no tilling of soil, no fertilizers, and no weeding is done. So when the crop is fell into the land, it will grow naturally and there will be no human effort. In organic farming, is expensive due to the requirement of bulk manures. Yes, as I said in the previous page, it requires organic manure. Natural agriculture or farming is an extremely low cost farming method, completely molding with local biodiversity. As you saw in the no plowing, no tilting, no fertilizers. So it is extremely low cost. Okay, there are many working models of natural farming all over the world. The recent one is zero budget natural farming, as we researched in a popular model in India. This comprehensive natural and spiritual farming is developed by Padma Sri Subhas Palekar. So after going through all this information, we are coming back to solve this question. So the correct answer would be organic farming is expensive due to requirement of bulk manures, whereas natural farming is an extremely low cost farming method. Yes, this is correct as we saw in the explanation. Natural and organic both are chemical free and more or less poison free farming methods. Yes, this is also correct. Similarity, organic farming promote non-chemical pest control methods, whereas natural farming uses chemical pest control methods. No, this is incorrect. Both systems discourage farmer from using any chemical fertilizers. So if you go through our explanation page, key differences, organic farming requires basic agro practices, and in natural farming, neither chemical nor organic fertilizers are used. So if you go through all this information, the natural farming uses chemical pest control method. No, it will not use this one. So the correct answer would be both systems discourage farmers from using any chemical fertilizers. Yes, this is correct. So the key difference is this is similarity and This is similarity. This is similarity. So the correct answer could be option A. Moving on to next question. Questions. It is taken from autumn culture topic. Tarpatans is one of the central aspects of each among the following paintings: Varli painting, Kalamkari painting, Madhubani painting, and Kalighat painting. So this question has been inspired from 2018 question paper. In that year, there was a question about Banithani. So in the painting Banithani belongs to which school? It is the correct answer was Kishangarh school. Okay. So based on this formula, we have formulated this question for your greater understanding. So I will give you 10 seconds now for you to solve this question before proceeding to the correct answer. So before solving this question, we are moving to explanation page for extracting more information. Okay. So Varli painting is a form of tribal art. It is from North Sahyadri range in Maharashtra. Okay. So it is a Varli painting. The answer could be Varli painting. The Varli culture is centered on the concept of mother nature. It is also like our natural form. This is also centered with the concept of mother nature. Male gods are unusual among the Varli and are frequently related to spirits which have taken a human shape. So human shape is given a very important prominence here. One of the central aspects is the Tarpa dance. This is what the question in solving this area. The tarpa is a trumpet-like instrument is played in turns by different village men. Okay. The Varli painting has a geographical indication that under intellectual property rights act. Okay. So it is also very important information for the upcoming prelims. Okay. After going through all this information, we are coming back to solve this question. So the correct answer would be Varli painting. Tarpa dance is associated with the Varli painting. Okay. So moving on to next question. This question is taken from schemes and welfare measures and social issues, associated social issues. Who among the following are the beneficiaries of Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana? So question is about beneficiaries of this scheme. This question is not about the scheme, but only the beneficiaries of this scheme. First one is Fisheries Development Corporation, second one is Fisheries Federation, third one is Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribe persons. So we should find the correct answer. So this question has been inspired from 2017 question paper. In that year, there was a question asked about national pension system. And then the question is asked about who among the following can join, the people who can join this system. Okay. So based on this question, we have formatted this question. So before solving this question, I will give you 10 seconds for the correct answer. After that, we will look at the explanation area for the more information. So before solving this question, we are moving to explanation area for getting more information. So the Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana, it aims to bring about blue revolution. Blue revolution is for the development of fisheries and aquaculture through the sustainable development of fisheries sector over a period of 5 years. It starts from 2020, last year it was started, and till the year 2025. It was announced in the Union Budget 2019 and 20. Okay, so it is implemented by Department of Fisheries under Ministry of Agriculture and Animal Husbandry. Okay, so this becomes very important. Implemented by Department of Fisheries. And then who among the following are the beneficiaries, right? The fishers and fish farmers, Fisheries Development Corporation, self-help groups or joint liability groups in the fisheries sector, fisheries cooperatives and fisheries federation, the entrepreneurs and private firms, SEST women, differently able person. This is very, very important. And then entrepreneurs and private firms. These last two points are very important with regard to this Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana. So after going through all this information, we are coming back to solve this question. So as we saw in the explanation page, all the persons are beneficiary under the Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana. So the correct answer would be option B. All the people are the beneficiaries under this scheme. So moving on to next question. The question is taken from international relations and international organizations. So question is about Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, TTIP, is being negotiated between. So this partnership has been given impetus in recent times due to regime change in United States of America. So there are four options given. We should find the correct one. So before solving this question, I will give you 10 seconds for the answer. If you watch this, my previous talk after the reaching this question, you can predict the answer. So I will give you 10 seconds before solving this question. So this question has been inspired from 2019 question paper, 2019. In that year, recently India signed an important nuclear field, nuclear agreement with which among the following countries? So it was Russia. So It was frequently in news. That is why this question has been resolved. By inspiring from this question, we have formulated this question. Why? Because this has gained very important in recent time. Okay, so before solving this question, we are moving to explanation page for getting more information. The USA President Joe Biden, in his first address to annual Munich Security Conference, declared that the Transatlantic Alliance is back. That is why it has been in news. Okay. What is Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership means? It is an ambitious, comprehensive, high standard trade and investment agreement. It has been negotiated between the United States and the European Union. It was launched in 2013, but there was no conclusion at the end of 2016. So it has been left untouched from 2016, but it has gained importance after coming of Joe Biden government. TTIP will be cutting-edge agreement aimed at providing greater compatibility and transparency in trade and investment regulations by maintaining high levels of health, safety, and environmental protection. So these are the important objectives of this partnership. Okay. After going through all this information, we are coming back to solve this question. So as we saw in the explanation page, the correct answer would be option A. It has been negotiated between United States and the European Union. Okay, after solving this question, moving to next question. This question has been picked from a science and technology topic. Consider the following pairs. There has been three technologies given and their associated applications. Okay, so we should find the correctly matched pair from these three pairs. So this question has been inspired from this question, 2018 question paper. In that year, there was a question is about Bell A2 experiment, blockchain technology, and CRISPR-Cas9. So it has been, this three technology has been in mixed frequently. That's why this has been asked in 2018. So by inspiring this, from getting inspiration from this question, we have formulated this question for your upcoming prelims discussion. Okay, so before solving this question, I will give you 10 seconds for you to answer this question, and then we will solve the same question after going through all this information. So moving on to explanation area before solving, the blockchains are a new data structure that is secure cryptography based and distributed across network. So blockchain is associated with the cryptography and it is a secure one. Blockchain technology supports cryptocurrencies. So it is associated with cryptocurrencies such as Bitcoin. Bitcoin is one of the cryptocurrency. And the transfer of any data or digital assets under Minos experiment. It has been used in the world's most powerful neutron beam. So it is associated with particle physics. Pronucleus is the nucleus of a sperm or an egg cell during the process of fertilization. So it is associated with human reproduction. The technique of pronuclear transfer involves the transfer of pronuclei from one cycle to another. So these are all biological terms. You should be very clear about all these terminologies. The pronuclear transfer can be used for prevention of mitochondrial diseases in offspring. So that is why this technology has been gaining importance in recent times. It can be used for prevention of mitochondrial diseases in child and offspring. So after going through all this information, we are coming back to solve this question. So blockchain is associated with the digital currency, that is Bitcoin, and a Minos experiment is associated with the particle physics. Pro-nuclear transfer is associated with human reproduction. So question is about correct statement. So the correct answer would be option B. All the statements, all the pairs are correctly matched. So moving on to other topic. So we are landing now for the session 22. We have covered definition of freedom from polity, Gandhian politics from modern Indian history, 15th Finance Commission from economic topic, RTT monsoon from geography, seasonalized sea extent differences in Arctic and Antarctic from environmental angle, and the natural and organic farming from the angle of environment, the Tarpa dance from modern culture, Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana from welfare measure schemes, and transatlantic trade and investment partnership from international relations and agreements, and technology application from science and technology. So we have arrived here that we have covered diverse topics from diverse sources. So make sure that you are extracting best out of it. If you have any queries and questions posted here, we are very glad to solve all your questions and queries. Okay. So I hope these sessions were very useful. Stay tuned for the upcoming videos. Thank you.